bad to us.
Amen.
Today I have a message that I'd like to bring before you. A message that I've been talking with. About faith. I think even our lessons that we've had over the weeks, over the months, talked about faith. Anything that deals with God's word in some form or fashion speaks about faith.
Yes.
We're saved by faith.
Yes.
We're healed by faith.
Yes.
We can have faith that someone else is healed by our faith.
Yes.
That's something that we ought to be proud of. We ought to be happy about that.
Yes.
God has given us faith to not fear.
Yes.
Faith to be delivered. Faith to be healed. Faith to be set free.
Yes.
Well, I remember hearing Jesus in the Word says, in all of Israel, no one had the faith as great as some of those that he speaks of in the Bible. And because of their faith, they were healed. One of the messages that I have today is faith requires action.
Yeah.
Faith requires action. We know that we don't have to have works in order to be saved. But now, as we've said, when you're saved, then you ought to be doing something. You ought to be doing some work then because you have been saved. Because God gave us his son.
Yes.
Because his son gave us his life. Because his son bore stripes on his back for our healing. Because he has done so much for us. We ought to just feel like doing something for the Lord.
Yeah.
As I studied and as I started going over the scriptures, I started seeing where faith requires action.
Okay.
And we ought to do something if we have faith. If we have faith, we ought to do something to make sure that everything stays right. If the doctor tells me that there's something wrong with me, and I have enough faith to be healed, then I ought to act like I have enough faith to be healed. I was looking at the word faith and looking at the word action. Faith requires a corresponding action. Faith requires a kindred action, a relatable action, a related action. If I believe that I've asked God for rain, then I ought to start walking around with the umbrella.
Yeah.
Not walking around with the umbrella up, because see, then somebody will say he's crazy, something's wrong with it. But when I leave the house, I should at least have my umbrella in the car if I pray for rain, because I'm looking for God to do something according to what I have prayed for. So there ought to be some related actions to what my faith is. A kindred action. A relatable action. There must be some type of response toward that faith that I have. If I believe that I'm going to be healed of sight, of vision, then I shouldn't take my glasses off and mash them into the soil.
No.
Because see, God is going to heal me if I'm believing for that. But he's going to let me know at the time, see, these glasses are for a particular vision where I can't see as well without them. So now when it gets to where I can't see well with them and I can see better taking them off than I can with them on, then the healing is starting to take place.
Amen.
So it is the same thing with other areas of our body. If we're praying for a healing, then sooner or later, we ought to be able to start to feel that healing coming to pass.
Amen.
There ought to be some type of actions that we have toward that. One of the actions that I would have is if I'm looking for a healing every day when I get up and put my glasses on, and I say, Lord, I'm thanking you for my healing, and I'm waiting for it to come on. Because that is the action that is coming out of my mouth in relation to what I've already prayed for.
Amen.
So what I'm trying to say is there ought to be some type of corresponding action to what you have asked God for.
Amen.
You ought to be doing something concerning towards or in relation to what you have asked God for. I was looking at Isaiah, and it was saying Isaiah 40 and 31. And it says, but they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. And they shall walk and not faint.
Mm-hmm.
See, if we're waiting on the Lord, if we're waiting on the Lord to do something for us, if we have asked Him to do something for us, and we're waiting on the Lord to do that for us, then we ought to act like the Lord is going to do this for us. We ought to speak like the Lord is going to do this. We ought to be saying it all the time, Lord, I've asked for it, and I know it's on the way.
Yeah.
There are things that I've asked the Lord for, and I'm waiting for those things. But I'm letting them know that, Lord, I'm still waiting. And I'm thanking Him every day. When I get up, I'm thanking, Lord, I thank you for that blessing that you're going to give me. I thank you for that healing that you're giving me. I thank you for what you're doing for me.
Yeah.
Because I have a corresponding action that is coming out of my mouth thanking God for what I've already asked Him for.
Amen.
I wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. He shall renew their strength. But they that wait upon the Lord, He shall renew their strength.
Yes.
They shall mount up with wings like eagles. I was thinking about waiting. And you heard me say this before. I go to a restaurant and a person comes to the table to wait on me.
Uh-huh.
And see, I say, waiter. Well, that person, their job is a waiter. They come to see what is it you need. They take your order. Then they go and see, give it to someone to prepare that order for you. They're not the cook, they're the waiter. They're the one just taking that message back and forth. Then also, that same person, when you go to a restaurant, same people in that category, in that job description as a waiter. You'll see them polishing the silver, wiping off the dishes, preparing napkins. You may even see some taking plates off of another table, getting it ready for another person to come. Their job has different descriptions, different things that they do, but they are still a waiter. But see, some folks that are waiting on the Lord, they're sitting and not doing anything.
Watch out, preacher.
They won't even clap their hands when the Lord is bringing forth praise.
All right.
If the Lord, if you have faith to believe that He is your God, He has done something for you, then you ought to be waiting on Him. You ought to be polishing a praise off to the Lord.
Right,
you ought to be preparing something and wrapping it and making sure that that praise is ready for the Lord. Because see, the Bible tells us that He inhabits our praise. He lives in our praise. And if He is so good that His Son come from majesty down here to give up His life and walk as a pauper, walk as a poor person, not a pauper that did not have, but a commoner, just like us. He came down and become just like us so that we could be just like Him.
Amen.
And when I say be like Him is because He came from royalty and went back to royalty.
Yeah.
And by Him coming here, it causes us to become royalty. And many of us think, we have our jobs, we go, we work, we have our retirement. God has blessed us with retirement. God has blessed us with all the necessities that we need. And if we could have been just like the man that is on the corner that has the sign that says, I will work for food. And he's sitting there with a little dog, and both of them look like they could use a meal. And this is the way that he receives his living. This is the way that he receives his substance. This is the way that he receives that will keep him. But God has blessed us.
Yes,
that is owed a praise.
Yes.
I was looking at that.
Yes.
Thank you, Jesus. That is owed a praise. God has given so much to us. A lot of people, they take it for granted that this is my food. Looking at Mark 4:26-28. And it reads, it says, and he said, so is the kingdom of God, as if a man should cast a seed into the ground, and should sleep, and rise night and day, and the seed should spring up and grow up. He knoweth not how, for the earth bringeth forth fruit of herself. First the blade, then the ear, and then the tongue. When I look at this, it shows me how Jesus is talking about when we cast the seed of faith. And how that, if that seed, whether it's monetary, whether it's physical, whether it's a giving of somehow to someone, that we're going to receive a return for it. That seed is going to grow. First the blade, then the ear, then the four corners. And when I look at the scripture, it shows how it says that man has cast that seed, and that how he goes to sleep, he wakes up, and goes to sleep. So it's like time takes place, and then comes the first blade. Then after the blade comes the ear, and then after the ear comes the four ear comb. And then the scripture goes on to say, and then he immediately puts the sickle to it, and he receives his harvest. There are so many ways that we plant seeds as Christians. Many of it, a lot of it has to do with our giving. Giving is one of the things that God wants us to do.
Yes.
He wants us to sow into the kingdom. The Bible says, it says the kingdom of God is as if a man sowed. So God has designed us. He has proportioned us. He has made sure that we are able to give.
Yes.
And you have some folks that say, well, I can't give. I can't afford to give. Well, once some have said you can't afford not to give.
Amen.
And see, some say, well, I don't have enough to take care of myself. When I take care of my car note, when I take care of my rent, when I take care of my light bill and the other necessities that I have, then I don't have any more. Well, let me show you something. Jesus showed an illustration of a widow that gave two mites. The interpretation of that two mites is a half a cent. Two mites make one half of a cent. And it says that when she gave into the treasury, she gave all that she had. But then there were others she gave out of her lot. She gave out of that she did not have. But then there was others that were giving, and they were given out of their abundance. Mm-hmm. And it says that this woman gave more than all the rest of them because she gave from what she had. All. A-L-L that she had. The Bible says, give and it shall be given unto you. Luke 6:38. Give and it shall be given unto you. It didn't say get and then give and it shall be given unto you. It says give and it shall be given unto you. You might say that I have faith to believe that God is going to bless this man. You see a man needs clothing and it needs food, and you say, well, I'm going to pray that God bless you. I have faith to believe that God is going to bless you. Your faith is dead.
Amen.
Your faith is dead. Because if it's food and clothing, you're sure that you can help that person in some instance. Yesterday we had the women had the, I guess I would say we had.
Amen.
I guess they don't want to take credit for that. Yesterday the women of Trinity had a free yard sale. Free yard sale. The only thing that you had to have to get it was energy, an action to come pick it up.
Right.
And then it was yours. It was of your choosing. That's giving. We have to know that, we have to understand that that man that we see needs clothing and needs food, and we turn around and say, I'm going to pray that God will bless you. I have faith. Then our faith is dead. Because see, if we see the individual that need that, we can take care of that. You know, now we need to put some type of corresponding action with what we believe that can happen for that individual. I have faith to believe that God will supply your needs. Well, we need to work on that. There's some type of way. God has blessed us to be able to fix that to a certain degree. God has fixed that to a certain degree within our life. And the Bible says, give, and it shall be given unto you.
Yes.
I've seen families before that, over my lifetime, I've seen families that the mother is on welfare. The child is on welfare. The grandchild is on welfare. And you wonder, why is it that they can't change from that environment that they're in? Some like that environment and everything is okay. But there are others that want to come out of that environment. But right here, God gives us a formula that Amen. Says you can come out of that environment. Because it says that if you give, it shall be given unto you. If you give. But now, if you see that person, if that person does not give, just like this lady that had the two mites, she gave. Now, it does not go and give us an illustration of what happened to her. But I would have to believe, knowing the God that I have and the Jesus that is in me that saw this situation, when she gave all that she had, he blessed her to be able to give more the next time. He blessed her to be able to be sustained in what she needed. Because he saw her lack. He saw that her heart was greater than her lack. She gave out of that she did not even have.
Yeah.
She could have said, I'm going to go to the store and I'm going to take this and I'll be able to get me a cracker or something. But she didn't do that. She gave into the treasure.
Yes.
And the Lord said that she did more. Her giving was greater than all the others.
Yes.
Some say they don't understand the giving process. Some don't understand how you can give. Well, you got to have faith. God says in his word that you have to be a cheerful giver. You can't give and be grudgingly giving, because it won't do you any good. It may do somebody some good that received, but it won't do you a bit of good. God is, you have your reward for what you did then. You know, you have the reward of saying, I did this or I did that. Luke 21:2, it says, and he saw a certain poor widow cast in thither two mites. Cast in thither two mites. And her giving was greater than all the others that gave at that time. It's something how Jesus can see so much. He has tried to get us to understand so much in his word. And how he would see these different things and bring it to the word. Put it in the word so that we can have it ourselves.
Yes.
There's so much that so many folks in those areas, in those areas, did not receive because the written word was not laid out there for them. But we have so much of an advantage over them because everything has been placed in front of us. We have the written word. I mean, you can go to a hotel or motel. There's usually a Bible there. Folks can go to jail these days. There's usually a Bible there. You can't run from the word. The word is going to be somewhere to where it will be written. It will be jumping out at you. And what we need to understand is that in this day that we live in, the way technology is, the way that we have the word before us, that God is going to be very angry at us. I feel that the penalty is so heavy on us by us not making sure that someone has this word.
Amen.
By us not reaching out and grasping Amen. The word ourselves as we should.
Amen.
The more that we read God's word, the stronger we become in God's word. When I look at Jesus' giving, how it says that he took and he speaking to the multitude and holding them all day and were hungry. And Jesus said, asked his disciples, I believe the word is saying, what do you have? And he said, we have a few fishes and a few loaves of bread. And how the Bible says that he took and broke these few loaves of bread. Well, now the disciples are wondering, how do you get rid of it? This is getting kind of, there's a lot of people out here, and we only have this little fellow here, that's all he has. And this is only enough for him, basically, maybe a little bit for his buddy, but we have a lot of folks. Well, God worked a miracle there. And there are a lot that try to come and break this down to say this did not happen. But see, I know Jesus. I know God. I know the God that I serve. I know just the little bitty miracles that we've seen. Just the little bitty things that he has showed us in our eyes. Just the testimonies that we hear from Sister Wallace and other individuals here. Everybody here has a testimony of some magnitude.
Yeah.
Everybody, even the little child has a testimony. Because there are many individuals that I've listened to, even young folks, how my mama said that I wasn't supposed to make it. I was premature, or I was this, or I was that. But they yet made it anyhow. Now that little child was sick at one particular time, and mama called one of the other members and said, my baby's sick, and I want you to pray. Now, I'm taking it to the doctor, but now the doctor can't do no more than God allows him to do. We have to face that. When we go to the doctor, we need to be praying, going in the door, saying, Lord, do something to his hands. Make sure that he has the right medicine. Make sure that everything is just like it should be, because I'm going here because I don't know what it is.
Amen.
And I'm hoping this gentleman knows what it is, and that you have given him the wisdom to be able to instruct me the right way.
Yeah.
And then if you leave there, the doctor can't do you no good, then you can go and tell the Lord then, Lord, it's all on you now. The man you left me, led me to, he didn't know it. So now only thing that I can do is whatever you have for me, this is what happened. See that woman with the issue of blood, she had said that she had exhausted all her money.
Yeah, that's right.
That she had been to all the physicians and gave them all of her wealth. She was in a condition to where she wasn't supposed to even be out there in the public.
Amen.
This was her condition. She wasn't even supposed to be in the public, and that was the law at that particular time. But this woman in her mind, with the faith that she had, she said, if I could just touch the hem of his garment, I believe that I can be made whole.
Amen.
Now, see, she had the faith to believe.
Yes.
But then she had a corresponding action that went along with it, and that was just for her to make sure that she could just touch the hem of his garment. And I know that it worked, because the Bible said that Jesus turned and said, who touched me? The Bible tells that he was thronged. There was so many people around him that the disciples said, Lord, everybody's touching you. Everybody's around you. But this woman had faith to say that if I bump him, if I can just get to him, then I can receive my blessing.
Yeah. Yeah.
And the Bible says that then she was made whole.
Yeah.
Then she was made whole. And that is important for us to understand, because, see, look, we may come to a time to where the doctor can't do us no good.
Right.
And see, we might have to be like Hezekiah. When the prophet come into Hezekiah and said, get your house in order, it's over, baby. You done did all you can do. It's it. That's it. And Hezekiah, he was speechless, because it didn't say that to the man right then.
Right.
This is what this is from me now. He was speechless. He didn't say that to him. See, if somebody comes to you right now and say, look, it won't be long. You gone. You getting up out of here. This is over with for you. Your tongue is tied. You can't say nothing.
Yeah.
But I can guarantee you one thing. When Hezekiah turned his face to the wall and he started talking to the Lord and said, Lord, this is what I've done for you. I thought that I was doing you a good deed. And the Lord, before he got out of the court, before he got out of the yard, he said, go back and tell him. I'm going to give him an extended time.
Amen.
And he gave him an extended time.
That's right.
You see what I'm saying? There may be a day in our lives when we may have faith, but we ought to at least have something in the fire. We ought to have something, at least something in the book. We ought to have something. If we don't have nothing there, we ought to have a scripture that says, Lord, your word said.
Amen.
You see what I'm saying?
Amen.
Your word said, Lord. Your word said. Because, see, it was Jesus' word that told those disciples to give me the fish. Mm-hmm. And it said, break them. 12 baskets. And the Bible even tells us when they got through feeding the 5,000, plus the women and the children, that they had 12 baskets left over.
Right.
So now, I like that kind of God, that when he's going to bless me, he's going to give me some extra.
Yeah.
Give me a little bit of extra.